Thank you for tuning into LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network for original reality radio and crafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Stay tuned.
Welcome to WDC Radio. I'm your host. I'm WDC. I want to thank you for tuning and listening today. As you know, this platform is for sickle cell trait awareness, but also I'm a military veteran, so we talk about military topics. Trench Talk is my segment. Lupus for community outreach, bullying, mental health. But today, I'm going to take control of the mic today. I got something to share with the community about how I became this advocate. You know, you've been following my story, and I actually have someone here who inspired me to have that conversation about being an advocate. So just stay tuned for that. If you want more information about sickle cell trait, go to WDCONSCT.org. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram at IMWDC. This is my theme song by my man DJ Tantrum. Shout us out, What's the Count? Check it out. That's Tantrum.
Listening in.
This is my Trench Talk segment. All right, so again, for more information for sickle cell trait, go to WDCONSCT.org. What I'm going to share with you today, this is my personal story. This is how it pretty much all got started. Dr. Ash is here. He's going to be sharing we're going to talk about how I met him and how this advocate for sickle cell trait even became, and then the work, and now you see where we are today here on the radio sharing about sickle cell trait and other things as well. But what's interesting is the day that I collapsed in September 14th, 2006 at Camp Roberts RTSM, I was at ANOC working on Master Sergeant rank and did the exercise test, the push-ups, the sit-ups, and I did the two-mile run. I collapsed. They said I was dehydrated, heat stroke, nothing sickle cell trait related. Ended up going back to the hospital that night because my condition got worse. Found out I had what they call rhabdomyolysis, so my muscle enzymes were breaking down. I had kidney failure. Both kidneys were at like 50%. Vertigo. Just terrible situation. But at the same time, there was a message that went across the network to the other schoolhouses. And I didn't know that until 2015, where I met Sergio, who's on the line, who's going to tell you that he was at a school in another state, and they came across the airwaves, and the instructors reported to them that a soldier had collapsed, and to make sure that you hydrate when you exercise. And he's going to tell you what he heard from the day that I collapsed. And we're in the same motorcycle club now, and had no idea that this was even had been said. So, Sergio, are you there?
I'm here.
Hey, how you doing? Let me end this real quick for you. Are you there?
Yeah, I am here.
Hey, how you doing, man?
Good, good.
Hey, I want to thank you for calling on the line, man, and sharing my experience of my sickle cell trait exertion and this rhabdomyolysis and how it affected my career in the military. But the message that you heard that same day come across to your schoolhouse. So introduce yourself to the listeners, and then we'll get into how this all transpired.
Okay.
So introduce yourself.
Okay, so I am sergeant first. I'm also on active duty. Sergeant first class. Been in the military for 14 years. Got a couple more years to go. And like you mentioned, I met you last year, and we happened to be telling the story of what happened to you that day, and I heard it from another way of what actually happened. So. You want me to go with that?
Yeah, so we were talking one day at the Vet Hunters motorcycle meeting, and I was sharing my story with some other the Vet Hunters, and he was like, "Hey, wait a minute. Like, I think I heard your story back then at the schoolhouse." So where were you at the time?
I was in Farron, Kentucky. We were getting ready to take our Army Physical Fitness test, and just like you mentioned, part of the safety briefing that we had before our actual test, that's when it came out about, you know, ensuring that people were, you know, that we were staying hydrated because somebody had collapsed while doing the 2 mile run. Since then, that's what I've been briefing all my soldiers before the run to don't take it as a joke. And then I made sure in 2015, so it was pretty crazy story.
That's pretty phenomenal. For him to be at Fort Knox, Kentucky, to get that message from his instructors as they were getting ready to take an exercise test, that was my story. And he's been briefing that to his soldiers since 2006.
That's wild.
Man, Sergio, I appreciate you for calling, man, and sharing that. That's a very important piece. Because it lets me know how important that awareness is, and even how efficient the military is to get that information out across the networks to the other schoolhouses, so they can educate and bring awareness to making sure the soldiers stay hydrated. Very important.
No problem.
And thank you for sharing that too.
No problem.
All right, I appreciate you, man. I'll see you on the next run.
All right, we'll see you.
All right, thanks.
All right.
So that's. To me, I was blown away that day. When he told me that, I was like, "Are you kidding me? Like, you heard that message?"
Yeah.
He was like, "Yeah, I was at Fort Knox, blah, blah, blah."
Small world.
I'm telling you, small world. So, again, I'm Farron Dozier, also known as WDC, and 24-year veteran. I served in the military for 24 years, medical retired 2 years ago. My quick story is, I found out I had sickle cell trait in 1999. Found I had sickle cell trait. They called me back at the LA Air Force Base in a panic. Asked me, did I know if I had sickle cell trait? I said no. They said, okay, well, we just want to let you know. But no really information, no brochure, no, just that was it. So I'm 29 years old, prime of my career. I'm playing basketball 3-4 times a week, you know, 4 or 5 hours at a time. Never had any kind of health concern or anything in my whole career. And then one day I collapsed in 2006. So from 99 to 2006, you know, I had been doing my thing. What I did remember when I started to play it all back was that my arm would ache at 5 years old. And they told my grandparents that it was growing pains in 1975. And I just learned to live with that pain.
Right.
No sickle cell trait, you know, never talked about or anything. Come to find out that was actually a part of a sickle cell trait pain crisis that I have, you know, from the trait. Mm-hmm. So some people with sickle cell trait, as we talk about later, have pain episodes. So my whole life, I've been dealing with this arm pain, just became a part of me, you know. It wakes me up out of my sleep at night. It aches real bad. Mm. My grandmother would hold me over the sink and run warm water, only thing that would soothe it.
Mm.
The same kind of pain that I described when I started advocating was the same kind of a pain that people with sickle cell disease experience. So So during my career, I collapsed 2006. I went to a neurologist because I was left with double vision and vertigo. The rhabdomyolysis had never, they said it was a freak accident. Didn't really know what it was, didn't really do any research until recently about even what rhabdo was, but I knew that that's what I had. My CPK levels were over 12,000 when the night doctor caught me, because I went to the doctor twice.
Right.
That's muscle breakdown.
Muscle breakdown. The first doctor was like, "You ever had kidney problems?" I says, "No." He says, "Well, you do now." And then he walked out. And wow. So he gave me a couple IVs and said, "You know, just go get some rest. You'll be okay." But because of the CPK level, the muscle breakdown, it was still happening. So my body was getting worse. So the night doctor saw that my levels were high. And then he put me on IVs for 4 days straight to flush my system. Again, it was just dehydration. No sickle cell conversation even talked about. Until 2010, I developed a case of arthritis. What happens is when I turned my paperwork into the military in 2009, I wanted to go back to the school to get my next rank, my E8.
Mm-hmm.
So I turned that paperwork in, and they says, "Well, you're not fit for service." And I'm like, "What are you talking about? Like, that paper's old. I went to the neurologist. I just can't run."
Right.
So I should get a profile. I could do the walk or the bicycle, something like that. They says, "No, we're gonna put you on the medical board." So I was like, "All right." So I could almost now play it back. Like, I could see myself that depression start, and end up being depressed for 2.5 years. Going to the LA Air Force Base from 2009 until 2013, I was being seen by doctors there. The doctor at the time, when I met Dr. Ash, he was going on leave. So he was going on leave, and he asked me, "Well, I'm going to be off next week. You know, do you want to come in or do you want to wait?" And I'm like, "No, I'll see whoever's coming."
Right.
So he's like, "Okay, well, I'll schedule the appointment." So that day I go to the doctor. I check in, I sign in, and Dr. Ash is there. And we're sitting there. I'm sitting there, and I go inside, and he sits me down. And he's like, "Okay, you know, I read your paper. I read some of your packet. What's going on?" I tell him, you know, I've all this stuff about the rhabdomyolysis, the sickle cell trait, and now I got arthritis. Now my physical is impacted. Now my mental is impacted. My physical, like, I'm in a, and he'll tell you, messed up. So he sits down. He has his book, and he's like, "What are you gonna do when you retire?" And I'm like, "You know, make some, you know, God bless me with a sports brand, so I'll probably sell some T-shirts, some hats, sit on the dock of the bay." That was my retirement song. Sit on the dock of the bay, mm-hmm. Watch the tides roll away. He says, "Well, you know, you can be an advocate." And I'm like, "All right, what's that?" And he was explaining to me what advocates do: become speakers. You can share your story. And then he opened up his book, in his college book, and he showed me a paragraph of rhabdomyolysis, about student athletes have been collapsing and dying, and having health complications from sickle cell trait.
Right.
So now I'm in tears, like, somebody finally, like, "You understand what I've been going through this whole time?" He's like, "Yeah, it's happened, but it's just not, you know, the awareness is not there, and people don't really talk about it. The doctors don't really know. They don't recognize it. Sometimes it gets misdiagnosed, you know, whatever. It just doesn't get looked at."
Right.
And so from there, it's like the little light bulb in the cartoon comes on, popped up on my head, and it's like I knew what my purpose in life was. And all that negative energy of staying up all night and, you know, worrying about what was happening to my life, I started doing more research on sickle cell trait, and saw how even the military soldiers had been collapsing and dying in the 70s and 80s from sickle cell trait and sickle cell anemia. And then they started screening people with anemia that couldn't join the military, but sickle cell trait could still join.
Right.
So here, as you see in front of me, I have Melvin, and I have Dr. Ash, who was the mental health provider that day that I credit to helping me and actually, you know, sparking that vision of becoming an advocate. So Dr. Ash, please introduce yourself.
I'm a psychiatrist, Ventura County right now. Was Air Force 21 years, 8 active, 13 reserve. Was at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, and University of Kansas medical grad, I should add that, with a master's in exercise science. And that's important because I also coached at Ohio State and Kansas, and so I've really, even though I'm not a sports medicine doctor, I've always followed that medicine piece in, connecting with sports. And as part of my book that came out, I looked into all the different aspects that connect sports to medicine, and one of them happened to be sickle cell trait. So to make a long story short, I'm doing reserve duty at this time when I meet Farron. And I'm living in Newbury Park and getting up at 4:30 in the morning to drive in. It was my second week, I think, of reserve duty, so I'm really pretty tired at this point. And the funny thing was I saw him at 11 o'clock. And why do I remember that? Because I'd just seen two other folks, and I was thinking about lunch. that was what was on my mind. Am I going to eat at the BX Burger King, or am I going to go off and go to Sizzler or something like that? So I also do a lot of consultation with primary care, and I got a consult for would I evaluate this individual for depression, and would I consider starting a medication on him? And so Farron sat down, and we started talking. And oftentimes what happens in a session is sometimes things just click. And you just feel like, you know, we were talking about sports earlier, you get in the zone. Yeah. And that's exactly how I felt when we were talking, is all of a sudden I felt like I was in the zone. As a psychiatrist, a lot of times it's not, I don't think about the words, I just let them flow. And that's exactly what happened, because once I showed Farron the piece about sickle cell trait, I just recall just tears coming down his eyes. And I did not tear, but I could tell you I was very emotionally moved. And so, yes, there was a lot of medical stuff that we talked about, but I have a very strong belief that no matter what med someone's on, and yes, I do prescribe, depression, I really believe, can hit anybody. And none of us are infallible, and I really believe that no matter how life changes us, because it does, if we don't have a passion, we don't have something to live for, it's very hard to get up. And I don't care who you are. And we can use the athlete analogy, the guy who plays in the NFL or plays in the NBA, and then they retire, and then what are they going to do with their lives?
Yeah, exactly.
And sometimes what happens to you makes you unique. And that uniqueness actually can, even though it was a negative, all the stuff that happened to Farron, my thought is when I work with someone, how can you take that negativity and channel that in a positive direction, and then actually that uniqueness becomes a part of you? So this is what I do with everybody. Every single person I work with, I think about how can I talk about two things. One is, what is peace to you? And the second is, what makes you unique and how can you make that a positive? But the truth is, most people, you know, I'm sure they respect me, they listen to me. But about a year later, I think, I'm sitting in my office in Ventura County, and I'll never forget it. I got a call from my OA up front, who said, there's a gentleman from the Air Force who wants to talk to you. And I said, a gentleman from the Air Force? And lo and behold, it was Farron. And he said, you won't believe this, but I have started an advocacy, and I'm doing this for sickle cell trait. And I just want you to know that I heard those words, and I'd met him one time.
Yeah.
So I was really touched, and of course then we kept in touch as part of my reserve duty, and we can talk if you want at some point about some of our other meetings that we'd have at Sizzler, by the way. That's our hangout place. But it's one of those things that you go into a helping profession for a reason, and then when the fruition of your work just kind of comes through in the way that it has, it means a lot.
Yeah.
And to give, you know, it's very nice to be sitting here saying all what I'm saying, but the truth is Farron did all the work. He really did. And so kudos and hats off.
Absolutely.
But thank you so much for having me.
Let's share with the listeners how important that day was, because I really thought my life was over. Mm-hmm. Like when I play it back, it's like my life was over.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I had a lot more military stuff I wanted to do. I wanted my career. You know, I had how I thought it should look. And what I started to notice was, years later, is that my identity, it was that identity of being that soldier, being that Sergeant First Class, that was being taken away from me. And to sit with him that day, I have a cousin, shouts out to Nigel, who has sickle cell anemia. Even back then, at 29, we never put the two and two together.
Right.
You know, when the Air Force Base told me, like I said, it just in one ear, out the other. When I became advocating, I was like, okay, it's inherited. So that means I got it from one of my parents. So my mom's like, well, it ain't me. My dad's like, well, it ain't me. And I'm like, all right, so I can't be advocating. And I don't even know from my own,
bloodline.
So having to talk with my dad, and then remember my cousin Nigel was like, hey, man, it's got to come from your side of the family because my cousin has it. So my dad at age 60 at the time went and got tested and realized that he was a sickle cell trait carrier.
Oh, wow.
At age 60.
Wow.
So it's very important, the advocacy work. The mental part of it, I mean, for me, the conversation that you shared with me, Dr. Ash, it triggered whatever that was. It had me think about something else outside of myself. And you saw that. And can you share with, I mean, writing that part in your book, what was going on before that, like, that had you even put that, you know, what did you see?
Well, as I've talked to Melvin too about this, when I wrote the book in 2009, the actual idea came with that in 1989 when I was coaching. And my two co-authors, I should mention, one is Michael Cawthon. He happens to be African American, and he was coaching at Ohio State with me. And the other is Pat Donnelly, who is a noted sports journalist in Minnesota. But I wanted to do a comprehensive book that covered a lot of things that most people don't think about in the recruiting process. And that's, you know, just throwing a plug in for Scholly Me too. That's what our social media network about getting high school athletes good fits with colleges is all about. But so you can go to download the Scholly Me app. But as an aside, the book was critical for me because I wanted to put together all sorts of things that no one talked about. For example, sexual assault on campus, concussions. And we talk about concussion all the time now, but back then, no one talked about it.
Right.
Sickle cell, sudden death because of heart becoming too big from exercise called cardiomyopathy. You know, gay rights. What if you're a gay athlete? What are you thinking about? How do you decide what university or what place is going to be accepting for you? A minority athlete, bullying, all these things. I wanted to be make it a comprehensive book, and it took 20 years to do. So that's kind of what I was thinking about. And when you and I were talking, I just happened to have my book there, and I just wanted to show you what it was about because it was right there and there. So what I recall from our meeting was I pulled the book out, and of course I handed you the page, and you read it, and that's when it really hit.
I read that, and I was like, this guy, like, he just shedded some light on everything that I had been living through.
Right. Yeah.
Like, literally my life experience up until that moment of that reading that page. I was like, because nobody, when I started going to the doctor, even the LA Air Force Base nurse was like, no, I don't know what to, like, we don't know what to do for you. Like, we don't know.
Right.
And so the arthritis, how I believe the arthritis came about was two ways. In 2009, when I turned that paperwork into the state surgeon's office, they sent me a letter back saying that you are no longer able to even exercise until we figure out, until we determine your health status. So they put me on the profile P4, which you can't do nothing. You can't even carry a rifle. You can't even wear the LBE, none of that stuff, helmet or anything. And I remember, okay, I stopped exercising. And then I remember one day, like, my knee started hurting. And then my other knee started hurting. And then my back started hurting. And then my elbow started hurting. And then my shoulder started hurting. And I'm like, all right, something's going on. Mm-hmm. And by January 1st of 2010, I could barely walk. I was as stiff as a table. Two things happened. That notification of stop exercising, because I was exercising at my own pace. And the other was, I remember taking the flu shot. And actually, it was the one that you inhale. And so I took the nasal, and I had a cold probably from mid-November 2009 up through January of 2010. Mm-hmm. And so maybe between the virus or whatever I got from that, or the not exercising, because now I'm not moving around anymore. I'm not, you know, getting my body, my blood flowing. However, arthritis somehow set in. So I went to the UCLA Medical Center, checked myself in. She ER'd me right away, and I ended up being in the hospital like 2.5 days. She pulled fluid out of my knee and was like, oh yeah, you have arthritis, and that was it. I'm like, huh? And she's like, here, take this shot. I'm like, hey, hold on. Like, nah, I don't want to take any medication. But I could barely walk. So I fought her from January to March, and they put me on Humira. And I started taking the Humira shots, which brought down the inflammation, but I still had the muscle and joint pains. When I met Dr. Ash that day, I did some research and found that Ryan Clark had been playing football in Denver. Yeah. And had a sickle cell trait exertion injury. He lost his spleen and gallbladder.
Mm-hmm.
Playing, and he could no longer play in Denver. And so all that stuff, you know, it just started to make sense. And then I saw how there were people who actually had heart attacks and died from the exertion of sickle cell trait because of the cardiac arrest, because the heart is a muscle. So when all those muscles break down, the last is the heart gets overworked, and then they have heart cardiac arrest. Discovering all that, man, like I said, it just had me just think about, like, this is bigger than me. And even that the brand that I had created that God gave me was What's to Count, was maybe it wasn't a sports brand. Maybe it was the piece, and he shared with me, well, maybe you could sell your hats. Like, when you told me about being an advocate, like, you broke it down. Like, you was like, well, maybe you can take your hats and T-shirts, and when you have your events, you could sell those, and that could help fund your next move, your next event. And I was like, are you serious? Like, I could actually become a person like that? He's like, yeah, you could be a speaker. You could do this and this. Explain, share that, please.
Well, you know, I think... first of all, backing up, I think it's important that when someone comes to a doctor, they want to be heard.
Yeah.
And part of our professionalism and compassion and hopefully interest for everyone out there that happens to be in a caring profession is that no matter whether you're hungry or not, you need to turn that hat off and you need to listen. And I think that's one of the biggest things that happened there is Farron hadn't really felt heard, even though he was wondering what's going on. And so once he felt heard, I think that allowed you to sort of realize, okay, if this is the case, now what can I do with it?
Right.
So going back to your question, though, one of the things that I always try and do is then I try just to say, go out and be an advocate. Well, that's not real helpful. But what I noticed about you, too, was that you were very personable, very friendly, very articulate and very intelligent, and you know, a little bias here, most folks in the military that have been in long enough, you don't stay in unless you're competent. So my thought was, this might be a good fit if we can then kind of talk through the process, and that's what we did the last few minutes of that session, was we really talked through how, kind of big picture, what could you do and how could you possibly connect this to what you're doing. So again, those are my recollections, but the fact that you took it from there and then called me up a year later and said you've got it in place, you know, that's pretty remarkable.
Yeah, and some of the stuff that happened in between that was he mentioned that to me about being an advocate. I go home, I'm up 3 o'clock in the morning, I'm researching, I'm printing off stuff to take to UCLA Medical Center, because I can now tell my arthritis doctor, hey, like, you need to look at this.
Right.
So I went, I printed up all this stuff, took it to her, and she was like, okay, she read it. So she's like, well, I'm gonna do another blood test. So And when he mentioned that to me, I went back to the Air Force Base and I got my physical that test from 99, and it was a positive sickle cell trait test.
Mm.
So I put all those documents together, took it to UCLA. She was like, okay. So she retested me there. Another positive sickle cell trait test came back. So I'm like, okay, makes sense. And then they were able to even go a little bit further and tell me that almost 40% of my S red blood cells are the S gene. So I'm like about a 60-40 in that category, right? So she's like, yeah, those numbers are kind of high, blah, blah, blah. So I'm like, okay. So the military was like, okay, well, we need that documentation so they can put that LOD packet in line of duty because I got hurt at the school. So it was all covered because I was in the schoolhouse. They put all that packet together. It took them about 300 and something days. Then I got the medical retirement. But during that whole time, the research that I found, it was phenomenal. And then I started going on social media, and I went on Facebook, and I typed in sickle cell trading and stuff, and I met my mentor. Her name was Phyllis Zachary Thomas, and she lived in Atlanta, and her organization was SCD Soldier Network. And I was like, this, you gotta be kidding me, like, it's a perfect match, because her husband was in the military.
Mm.
And so the sickle cell advocates consider themselves sickle cell warriors, soldiers. So that's what she had named her organization. So I met her with the information that you shared with me, the research that I found. I took all that. I met her on Facebook. We talked from that moment on. She saw how important that sickle cell trait in that conversation of awareness for sickle cell disease and the trait was important. So she embraced me. She taught me. She furthered the advocacy work of how to be an advocate. She taught me, hey, this is what you need to do. You know, it's about you. This is who you can. This is how you take care of the community. Make sure you follow through, follow up. She gave me all this. I mean, she reinforced how to be an advocate. And by doing that, I put that packet together, and I flew to the 38th annual SCD conference in Maryland.
Wow.
Paid my own way, put that packet together, flew out there. Kiki Shepherd, I don't know if you know who Kiki Shepherd is. She was hosting it.
Showtime with the Apollo.
Yes, she was hosting that event. And so I sat in the audience in the back. And then when she made her way with the microphone, I raised my hand to speak. And then she came to me and I'm like, yeah, I want to speak. And I gave her a whole packet of T-shirts and dog tags that I had. And I gave her my brochure on top, and she read it, and she was like, looked at me. And then so they got the microphone back, and she's like, okay, this is Farron, and he wants to share about sickle cell trait. So I stood up, and I just let him have it.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, this is who I am. I flew in from California. I'm an advocate. I mean, I'm an advocate for sickle cell trait, and this is what I'm here to share. And they were like, who are you? Like, what? Where do you come from? And one of the doctors, she took my brochure, mm-hmm. and she looked it over, and she gave it back that evening. She was like, can you change one thing? I'm like, okay, what's that? She says, well, can you change that? Can you kind of soften up where the part that says it causes sudden death?
Hmm.
I'm like, but that's a fact.
Right.
She's like, yeah, but we don't want to scare the people. So I went back and I got home and I changed it up and sent it back to her. And she said, okay, that's cool. Long story short about that is, even today it's been a challenge. Because that community has, we're separate.
Right.
It's like sickle cell trait is one conversation, sickle cell disease, and it's like September sickle cell awareness month. But then I get told, well, it's sickle cell awareness month. Why are you talking about the trait? This is sickle cell. Like, so I'm like, are you kidding me? So even in the community where I'm fighting for, to advocate for, I'm still like, not a part of that community because you only have the trait.
Right.
And it's like, well, when you back that up, those two genes come together. It takes two genes from each parent to inherit to the child. So we're a community. But I still get some feedback from that advocacy work.
And what I think people don't realize is that if you know you have sickle cell, it's always on the radar. If you have sickle cell trait, you like you were talking about, you knew, but you didn't think about it.
Yeah.
You didn't. It wasn't on your radar until this event happened.
Yeah.
And so your education piece is that people with sickle cell trait now are going to have this on their radar. and continue to think about it, and they go to practice, and the coach says, oh, let's do a two-mile run. Well, you know what? You can be a great athlete in many sports without running 2 miles. Same with the military. I shouldn't get in the military stuff, but you don't need to run 2 miles to do everything.
Right.
So those are the things that you're able to advocate for and put on the radar so people can think about it and talk about it and at some point step up and say, no, I'm not going to risk my life because there's someone who is ignorant about this and wanting to do something because they've always done this. So I think from that standpoint, it's really important.
Yeah. And can you share, you said something, can you share about the oh man, I lost what I was going to ask you. Anyway, I'll get back to it. It's so much advocacy work. There's so much conversation that goes along with that. There's so much, I have a caller actually. Let me see who's on this call. See, caller, you're live. What's the count? Hello, caller? Hello? Maybe they're just listening. No, they hung up. So again, becoming this advocate, Dr. Ash, I mean, you really did that for me. You the light bulb, man. That's how I share it. When you mention those conversations, it's like I knew what my purpose was. And when I met Phyllis, she passed away about 2 years later. But she was, this is how serious it is. She went to a meeting she went to go do a radio, TV interview. And there was a pastor, a prophet there. And he gave her a scripture in the Bible to go back and read. So that was a Sunday. On Monday morning, she calls me, like, Farron, you need to get your Bible. I'm like, okay. So we go to Judges chapter 4, and it's a passage about Deborah and Barak. And so we're reading the passage, and she's reading it, and I'm following along, and then we're both just crying. Like, you got to be kidding me. Because in that passage is a story about Deborah, who's a prophetess, and Barak was a soldier, and the war on Sisera. So when you play out these characters in this passage, Deborah, Barak, Sisera, Jabin, Jael, she was Deborah, the prophetess. I'm Barak, the soldier. Barak's mission was to go and find soldiers to fight the war against Sisera. So he was told to go find 10,000 soldiers to fight this war against Sisera. Sisera represents sickle cell disease, right? Because in this passage, it says that when Barak went off to fight that war, Sisera grabbed 900 chariots of iron and took off across, right? But I'm going to back up. Before that war started, God came in and made it rained. So the river was muddy. Kishon, the river was muddy. So when Sisera took off and grabbed those 900 chairs of iron and took off across that river, they sank because the iron was heavy, right? So he bails off and he takes off on foot. And he's running through the town, through the desert, and there's a tent set up. And it's Jael. And she sees him and she waves him in. Oh, come on, you can come in here. And he's like, hey, I'm tired. Can I get some water? But she gives him milk. And then he lays down, she gives him a blanket. Long story short, she goes out to the tent and grabs a tent peg and a hammer and she kills him. Right? So we're reading this in this passage, and it's like this is our blueprint of our life on the war, we call it the war on sickle cell.
Right.
Because my mission is, as an advocate, is to go out and find people or make them aware, because it's not about me. And the key thing about that war was God said for Barak to go, and he says, well, I'm not going to go unless you go to Deborah. And she's like, well, if I go with you, then you're not going to get the credit.
Mm-hmm.
And Barak's like, hey, I'm cool with that. I'll fight the war, but it's not about the credit. So he says, a woman's going to get the credit. And how that relates to me and Phyllis was, when I met her, wherever she wanted me to travel to, I would go. I would support her. I would help her. But I wouldn't go by myself, but I would go with her. And military-wise, you know, sometimes you have a female commander.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that military experience and training, I'm okay with having a woman train me in charge. And so none of that got in the way. And that's how that passage was for us. And when Sisera was killed by JL, it was like, for me, that's the community. She represents the community because that's where sickle cell trait hides out in the community, in homes, literally, if you look at it, in homes. And so when we played it all back, it was like, okay, God, like, it's like I'm that whole 24 years of military experience that I got from the military, I use that same mentality, those same tools to advocate for sickle cell trait. And again, I would have not even considered. I mean, when I talked to you that day, my life was over. Like, I was ready to drive off the freeway. Like, I had those thoughts of just crazy depression thoughts. And I still battle with it. But I, what helps me is I remember that it's not about me. When I get those dark spots coming back in my house and I'm all like, it's over, what am I doing? Like, nobody cares about sickle cell. Like, why are you even talking about sickle cell? Nobody cares. But then I go on social media and I see, you know, people suffering or in pain. And it's like, okay, that's why I'm, that's why I'm doing this.
Yeah. Right. Well, you know, two things come up. One is, you're speaking to something really profound, which is when you can combine spiritual with your passion, it is not just about you, but it's also really more powerful than you, because your heart and soul is directly into it. And I think that's what you're talking to there. The other part is that prevention, as you know, with our U.S. healthcare system, it never gets enough play. We don't know all the kids, all the other people who, because of your message, aren't in the hospital, aren't having kidney failure, aren't dead. All those aspects we're never going to see because the message has gotten out. And I just, sometimes it's hard, even as a provider, we don't always see the prevention piece.
Well, I'm going to tell you how you're right on the money, because I learned that from Phyllis, that because of this type of advocacy work, you don't get instant gratification sometimes. Like, some people need that instant gratification, but I learned that the ripple effect is more, even more powerful. Like, to have to share a message one day and then it goes full circle, and a soldier of mine or a friend of mine says, hey, I heard that from so-and-so, I need to talk to you, then I know that that work is effective. And even though I may post messages or say something on Facebook, on social media, or Twitter, I'm confident that somebody sees it. And I've been at health fairs. My first few health fairs, I'm set up with the tent and flyers and all this stuff, and nobody comes by. Oh, sickle cell? Ah, I thought I thought that was over. I thought that was over. And then the moment I go on stage and speak and go back to my booth, this lady came running through the crowd with her son. Like, you need to talk to him. You need to talk to him. She's like, can you explain to him? When he was playing, can you explain to him what you just said? And so I shared with her little son, and she was like, you see that? Like, we need to check that out, because he was fatigued. Number one, one of the main symptoms of sickle cell is fatigue. And so he was having those kind of tiredness and fatigues, and she wanted him to talk to me and kind of understand about, because he had sickle cell trait. So I have to be confident, and sometimes I don't remember that, that it's a ripple effect, and maybe I don't get that instant gratification of sharing my message.
Right.
And that's sometimes, for some people, that's the challenge, and that'll, you know, I'm not gonna do this anymore because I'm not getting that, oh, congratulations, thank you, right up front. I think that's kind of big.
Well, when you can put purpose with passion, that's what keeps you going. And again, reflecting back here to Melvin sitting next to me here, same thing with Scully Me. The advocacy for purpose and passion is really what, you know, think of all the stuff you've been through.
Absolutely. And when me and Dr. Ash met, the only experience I had with sickle cell was T-Boz from TLC, because I didn't know anyone at the time who had sickle cell. And so it was in the back of my mind what sickle cell was. But one of the things that Ash was passionate about, and I had a chance to read his book, and so it addressed some of those issues in his book. And we just wanted to make sure that when he was blogging on Scholar Me, and And when he's out in the community with Scholarmy, he wanted to do more than just talk about sports. Mm-hmm. He wanted to talk about issues. And I think that was very important to the both of us. And he mentioned you from day one, way early on, at some point that we have to get together. And he had told me your story. And even at that time, it was still kind of in the back of my mind. I said, yeah, I'll meet the guy. But I don't know anything about sickle cell. And none of my brothers had it. Yeah. None of my cousins had it. And nobody in my community had it. So it wasn't really that big of a deal and forethought. But I was behind his mission.
Yes.
Just recently, my daughter and my daughter's mother, we adopted a family for Christmas.
Okay.
And it was a 14-year-old boy and a 6-year-old girl. She has sickle cell.
Oh, wow.
And I went out there to meet the family. We took the gifts, went out there to meet the family. So I started to do research on sickle cell because of that. And I found out how profound it is in athletes that most athletes don't even know about that they have. So if the athletes don't know, the coaches definitely don't know.
Exactly.
So we're just going to push because that's just in our nature. So I did research on sickle cell trait, and so forth. And I went to meet this young lady. And when I was done with that, me and Ashley meet at Topper's Pizza every Wednesday. So he meets with you at Sizzlers or
wherever. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I get the
Sizzlers. He meets with me at Topper's, so we're going to have to change that. But I come back and I said, Ash, I'm all in. I said, I'm ready to go with the sickle cell thing because I finally saw somebody that was affected by something. And when you see somebody who's affected by it, it kind of changes your perspective on how you help. Not when you help, but how you help, you know. And so I wanted to get involved with that. And so I say, Ashley's just a wonderful psychiatrist, and he's doing a great job. And I like the fact that his blogs are going to be more than just about recruiting. It's about everyday issues, and sickle cell being one of them, and sickle cell being a big part of it. About everyday issues that these athletes and these coaches need to understand about each other and then that relationship, and then get the community that is most affected by sickle cell to understand what some of these symptoms are.
Yeah.
Because when you come in to come to a family that doesn't have the health care insurance, they don't understand that their elbow hurting is leading to something much greater. You know, mom would be, hey, we don't have the insurance for that. Rest is going to heal that. And then the ankle starts to hurt or something else. So if we know the system and we educate those on the symptoms, then we can educate them on getting tested.
I'm going to tell you, again, I played my life back a lot. And I can remember being at Fort Irwin. I was mobilized to train soldiers to go to that were going to Iraq. And so we were out there training soldiers to go to Iraq. And 2004, being in the desert, we exercised every morning, you know, all the physical fitness. But I found paperwork where I had been to the sick call because I could barely walk, or my hand swole, or my elbow was aching, and things like that. And they were like, oh, it's tendonitis. And again, I was probably having symptoms then in 2004 and 2005. And then that exercise test in 06 just was the top of the perfect storm. But I started to play back like, man, I had pains like that kind of symptoms back then, right? So I've kind of shifted my advocacy work to include rhabdomyolysis. Mm-hmm. So I actually found a holistic doctor that came on the show a few months ago that we actually did a rhabdomyolysis conversation. And rhabdomyolysis is rare, but it's not becoming rare anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Because I found a lot of people with the same CPKs, mm-hmm. even higher than mine, from doing CrossFit exercising.
Mm-hmm.
And my thing is, okay, if it happened to me with sickle cell trait, if that was my trigger, then what is it that this Caucasian female is having the same rhabdomyolysis condition then?
Right.
Does she have an inherited gene that she doesn't know about? How can a Hispanic guy have the same rhabdomyolysis condition? Now, is he aware? Like, so what is rhabdomyolysis in connection with sickle cell trait? And why I'm going to say this is, a lot of people with sickle cell trait, I mean, you guys know that, the fear of being... I don't want to say that. Not being able to play sports because you have that inherited gene, right?
Right.
That's, I think that's the fear of everybody's advocacy work, even with the sickle cell disease community. They now talk about sickle cell trait, but having that person being not discriminated against.
Mm-hmm.
And my thing is, first is, what's the value of life, first of all? You know? But now, is it really just sickle cell trait? But they've categorized that health issue with sickle cell.
Right.
If you have sickle cell trait, you got to be tested for sports.
Right.
Everybody's got to be. Right? But what about people that have thalassemia trait? Mm. What about people that have C trait? There's about 400 types of different red blood cell conditions that affect the red blood cells.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I met an officer in 2012 who had thalassemia trait. And he experienced the same symptoms that I experienced with sickle cell trait, from the exertion, the rhabdo, the urine, the dark urine. So I get the importance of the testing, but is it fair to say that you have to just test for sickle cell trait if this condition is happening to more than one gene type?
Right, but you guys are both talking about the awareness piece, which is so critical, because all three of us, I know, are parents.
Yeah.
And could you imagine sending your kid to a program or a school where the coach is like, oh, I don't care, that's not real, or if you don't run, you're a wussy, you know, that sort of mentality. It's like what concussion was, 10, 15 years ago.
Right.
No one cared. It was, you weren't tough enough. And, it's so funny. I was listening to Aaron Rodgers talk about something about concussions, and of course, the Green Bay Packers quarterback, and he was saying, now everybody is following the concussion protocol. They're going through this. And it makes a big difference because it legitimizes this for kids and coaches. And I think that's the piece that we're talking about here, is that the more awareness we can do, the more it becomes legitimate. And then coaches, trainers, medical professionals, kids, parents, we're all on the same page.
Yeah.
And that saves lives.
And it's mandatory screening now for sickle cell trait.
Right.
It's mandatory.
Absolutely.
But I get that. But my other part of that is going to be, is we got to make sure that everybody's taken care of. Because now, as we know, sickle cell trait is, yes, African Americans were number one. Hispanic community is number two now, because they're not aware that they carry that gene. Mm. So they're having more babies with sickle cell disease. So their numbers are rising.
Mm-hmm.
But you can be Mediterranean, European. Mm-hmm. So it's no longer what color your skin is with sickle cell trait. You've got to know your bloodline.
Yeah.
Right.
So it could be from any parts of your family gene. If you have family members that were, ancestors were born near the equator, because it fights malaria, so it does have a purpose.
Right.
Sickle cell trait does have a purpose. So you got to be able to know your bloodline. So there's a conversation that's beyond a superficial type of conversation. That it has to be had.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want the student athletes to be, well, you have sickle cell trait, but we got to be able to make that a blanket conversation, because a person with thalassemia trait can have the same type of health complication.
Yeah.
And so if I ask my mate, well, do you have sickle cell trait? She says no. And then we have a child, and then she has sickle cell SC. Then I feel like, oh, shoot, I didn't even know about S. What is the C trait?
Mm-hmm.
So there's... It's a lot more than just sickle cell trait. I get to bring awareness to those other red blood cell genes, because like T-Boz, she has sickle cell thalassemia.
Mm.
So she has a form of sickle cell disease.
Right.
All right.
So it's...
Farron, I was just going to comment that one of the things about growth as an advocate is what you're describing too. Seriously, right?
Yeah.
Is that you get involved with this because it connects to you directly, you have a passion for it, you have a spiritual purpose behind it, and then you grow with it. And part of that growth process then is you're learning all these other aspects that a lot of us, most of us don't know, and now you're able to educate from another perspective, which again is incorporating some more prevention for people that weren't thinking about it to begin with. So, just going back to the advocacy piece, part of that advocacy piece is a never-ending education and learning, and that's what you're doing.
Yeah, thank you. And I want to reintroduce Melvin. He was on the sports show. Melvin, you and I were talking in the lobby, I'm a community outreach guy. You know, sickle cell trait allows me to have this platform where I talk about lupus, bullying, mental health, military conversations. And you mentioned something about a basketball player that collapsed because the coaches, nobody knew CPR. Can you tell that story for my listeners, please?
Yeah.
Very important.
Some 20 years ago, I have a cousin who was playing. He was a phenomenal baseball player. He was about 14, 15 years old, phenomenal baseball player. And like everybody in my family, we played multiple sports. So he was also playing basketball for Rio Mesa High School, and they were at a tournament at Agora High School out there in Ventura County. And the team was losing, so they went to the press, and they started coming back. And it was about two or three minutes left in the game, and he actually collapsed on the court, and he passed away, basically. His heart stopped beating, and he was pretty much dead, and no one attended to him for the first 4 minutes. The referees were seen on videotape, kind of joking around how he fell, laughing. They kind of shoot him and kicked him up. And none of the coaches there knew CPR. None of the referees knew CPR. It was a young white lady who was in the stands, and she came running out of the stands and performed CPR. She was a nurse. So she had them call the ambulance, and she performed CPR until the ambulance came. And it was what's interesting about that is we've had a chance to talk to her since then. And the reason why I explained that she was a young white lady was because when we were at the hospital, she explained that she was prejudiced. And she wasn't going to come down there to save this little black boy. She thought that they would be able to handle it. But she said that she could not sit there and let this kid die. So she came out for performing CPR. She even went to the hospital where my cousin was at, and the family introduced herself to my cousin's mom, and they became really close friends after that. But my family actually sued the state of California and Rio Mesa High School, and it became a law, a national law, that every single varsity sport has to have a defibrillator at the games. If you don't have one at the game and somebody collapses, then you would get a major fine.
Wow.
Just recently, about a week ago, a young lady was playing volleyball. She collapsed. Her heart stopped beating. And they got the defibrillator off the wall, and it actually saved her life.
Wow.
And that was because of the Dante Nunnery lawsuit.
Wow.
So every single coach now has to know CPR. As you've been a coach here in Ventura County, you can't be a coach anymore without knowing CPR. That's the Dante Nunnery lawsuit.
Wow.
So... being an advocate at that time, I was doing it for my parents, and then we didn't want anyone else to have to go through that. So I know all about being an advocate, and then to be able to see that last week and say that is because of my cousin, because no high school is paying for it. And no one had really died on the court. You know, we saw hang gathers in college, but that was it. But to see this young lady who's playing volleyball and to be able to get that on her chest so fast was amazing. Now, my cousin is in his 30s now, late 30s, because he didn't have an oxygen to the brain for a period of about 4 minutes, he has limited function of his brain, so he can't really communicate with you, but he understands what you're saying.
Right. Wow.
And to see a promising athlete like that, and then he can't play anymore, and he can do anymore, all because the coach or the referees didn't know CPR. It's heartbreaking.
Yeah.
So you go back to sickle cell, to see some of these athletes, like you mentioned, the guy in Denver, he had to take his spleen out, right?
Spleen and gallbladder.
He couldn't play in Denver because of, the Mile High Stadium.
Yeah.
Because the altitude, and he couldn't play there. And then when he went to the Steelers, he couldn't play at the games when they played against Denver.
Yeah, this last time.
So Denver beat him exactly. In the playoffs because he couldn't come.
Exactly.
And he was their star safety.
Exactly.
So, he had to miss out on that because he has sickle cell. And I think that what you're saying is true. It's more than just a sickle cell that we have to be cognizant about. But the problem is, if the sports community is not aware of what that effect does,
right,
then we don't get involved and say this is one of those issues and situations where you are omitted to, and then you don't have to do the running.
Right.
It's not until somebody brings it to the attention. So same thing with concussion. You know, it was just getting your bell rung, but when you bring it to the attention of the sports community that says, hey, you keep having these and you're going to get CTE,
right,
then we're going to make changes. So we did that with sickle cell, but I don't think there was enough knowledge mm-hmm. on the other traits to say these are just as bad and just as effective as sickle cell.
Yeah.
And can do just as much harm to the athlete. Because I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Even before coming into here,
yeah,
I didn't know that. And so I understand the sports world because of our sports social network, and by me being an athlete and me being a coach, that if it's not brought to the right people's attention of which ones are the harmful ones, then those other ones we kind of just sweep under the rug.
And it's not to scare or say that your student athlete can't perform.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that they need more attention, more hydration. They may not be able to do 20 sprints at one time.
Right.
They got to do 15 and then rest and then do the other five.
Right.
It's not that they're lacking as an athlete. It's just that the body talks to you.
Mm-hmm.
Even when you catch a cold, you know, the body lets you know. And I just want those athletes to understand that your body will talk to you and it will tell you when something's going on.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I remember when I took off that morning, I felt this warm sensation come over my body. I'm sprinting.
Mm-hmm.
I could hear I did my last lap and I could hear the instructor 15:45, 15:46. And I'm like, oh man, I'm doing pretty good, you know?
Right.
And so we're trained. You sprint the last lap.
Right.
So I come around the curve and I'm like, okay. And I hear the time. I'm like, oh man, let me get this run over with. Mm. So I take off. But I do remember, like, I had this weird warm sensation, like heat just hit my body. And it's like 6:30. So I'm got the breeze, cold breeze hitting me, but my body just felt this energy of heat.
Right.
And I come across the finish line, put my hands in the air, you know, get my air in my lungs. And then I just started feeling a little weird. And I kind of like kneeled down and I just closed my eyes and I laid back. When I opened my eyes, everything was spinning like a million miles an hour.
Mm.
And I'm like, okay, so I closed my eyes back tight again. They come over with the medics. I can't stand up. I got this nauseated feeling, like, you know, just like I said, everything's spinning. And no idea what was going on. I didn't pass out, but I knew where I was. I was coherent. Mm-hmm. I knew where I was at. Right. But if I opened my eyes, I was done.
Yeah. And you know, we do this with so many other aspects of sport. For example, if we know someone has exercise induced asthma and they're having an asthma attack, we're not going to say keep on playing.
Right.
Now we have concussion protocol. Someone's coming off an ACL or something. We're going to treat them differently, not because they're wimps, it's because it's the right thing to do.
Right.
And I think that's part of what we're talking about here, is that if we can really get that message out and continue to get the message out, which is what you're doing, then more and more people have that awareness, and we're taking kids out of that position of having to fight for themselves, because that puts them in a tough spot.
And I've learned, you know, even these last 5 years, that there's so many aspects of sickle cell trait. You have the athletic part of it, but then we get to educate the students. Hey, you know what? Make sure you have this conversation with your mate,
mm-hmm.
your girlfriend. Like, you can have the superficial stuff, but you want to ask some serious life, you know, background conversations, because who knows? You could have a child with
right.
some form mm-hmm. of sickle cell anemia or disease.
Right.
So there's there's a couple of things that I get to sharing that message, or my experience allows me to educate on a few different levels
mm-hmm.
of the gene issue, but also the athletic, you know, awareness part of it too. So
right.
Dr. Ash, like I said, man, it just unfolded mm-hmm. to this from the office at LA Air Force Base to sitting here on the radio. I would have never where my mind was, you couldn't have told me that this was gonna happen ever. Like, I wasn't in that frame of mind.
Right.
Well, you never gave up. And sometimes, I mean, emotionally we all do. We're all human.
Yeah.
But you came back many times and just kept on at it. So really, kudos to you. And I've been practicing now for a number of years. I won't date myself or age myself here.
Yeah, thank you.
But really, what can I say? Just really hats off. And you took that message and ran with it.
Yeah.
and it's made a huge difference, and I know it will continue to. And just speaking, I think, for both Melvin and I, Scully Mee's proud to be here right now and be a part of this.
No. Absolutely.
I look forward to helping making the community awareness.
Absolutely. We just want to get to the athletes and the students as well and let them know about sickle cell.
And here's the other piece. I have my next guest here. Nikki, is that you?
I'm here, yes.
Hi, how are you?
I'm great, thanks. How about yourself?
I'm doing great. I want to thank you for taking the opportunity to call in and just share a little bit about your story on your experience with rhabdomyolysis.
Yes, thank you for the opportunity. This is something that I am so grateful for you bringing so much awareness to a topic that I had no idea about until I actually experienced it. Didn't know the condition existed. And it kind of set me back a little bit for a couple of years, but you know, you just keep on checking and try again.
Okay. Thank you. So let's go back in time a little bit before you had the rhabdomyolysis experience. What was going on in life before that?
Yeah, so I'm self-employed, and with that, I work in concert and tour management. So it's a very kind of physically grueling, field of work. And then we do a lot of traveling, a lot of air travel and things like that. And I had been taking some short trips back and forth from the East Coast to the West Coast, having no idea what that meant. I was an avid CrossFit person. Which I still very much love the CrossFit protocol. I just realized it's not something that I can do anymore. I'm going to have to take some time to get back up there and work that out. So I had taken about 2 months off of CrossFit just because my travel schedule was so busy that I just couldn't make the classes. And then I had decided it was time to get back involved in it. And after a couple months, I went right back into my class. And my trainer would have had no idea what my own lifestyle was like, so I can't blame anything on them. But I had taken about 3 short trips from the East Coast to the West Coast, all within about 72 hours.
Okay.
Went in and did about 75 GHD sit-ups kind of after taking 2 months off and went in. And I noticed that I was just not feeling so great, kind of what you were just talking about a little bit ago, where you know, you felt good, but you have this heat sensation.
Yes.
Kind of the same thing happened to me in that respect. And I then took yet another trip to Palm Springs. I live in Atlanta, so I took a quick trip from Atlanta to Palm Springs. And while I was there, I just noticed I was literally walking around. I felt like a ninja turtle. I couldn't straighten up. My stomach was so swollen. I had worn a pair of jeans that I'd been wearing for the past year. And literally overnight, I couldn't wear them anymore. There had such swelling in my midsection, but I didn't know anything about rhabdo. I had no idea the condition existed. So I had no idea what was happening. Fast forward, I had kind of noticed that my urine was dark, but I just figured, okay, I just need to drink more water. I'm dehydrated from traveling, so I drank more water. And it wasn't helping. So I came back to Atlanta, started doing, obviously going back to CrossFit again, and one particular workout that we had called for about 125 pull-ups, so I did those. And mind you, I had just turned 40 earlier in the year, so it was the year of my best body. I was pushing it, I was doing everything that I possibly could, felt great, was at my best physical shape that I had ever been in pretty much in my life. 20 years before, I had lost 100 pounds, very involved in martial arts. And kind of lots of different ways to keep myself active and have a very healthy lifestyle. And when I went back in that second time and I did those 125 pull-ups, something just didn't feel right. I became a T-Rex, which, again, having no idea that rhabdo even existed, that is a common trait. Me basically being a T-Rex, I couldn't bend my elbows. I had such pain in my biceps. That was deep inside. It was just such a strange feeling. And then I realized my arms started swelling. And I told my trainer, I was like, you know, I'm really swollen. I'm really sore. This is just really strange. And then there was so much fluid that had built up around my elbows. And I'm actually somebody who studied in mixed martial arts, did a lot of Brazilian jiu-jitsu. and on ground fighting, and my elbows were my weapons, because when you're training with nothing but a bunch of guys that are from the police force, I'm not really going to get out of a lot of stuff on the ground, but my elbows were my weapons that were like knives, and I could at least get myself back up on my feet where I was really strong. But I couldn't feel my elbows because there was so much fluid that was starting to build up around there. So I asked my friends, I was like, now, I know when you work out the term is that you're all swole, but this is a whole different version of swole that I don't think is normal. And some friends were like, oh, you know, just take it easy. So I was trying to do some yoga. I didn't go back to CrossFit because I was so sore. Something just told me inside, let's just take a couple of days off and let's rest. So I decided to do some yoga to try to get some fluid drainage in my system and stretch and whatnot, but I just could not straighten out my arms. It was just not happening. The next thing I knew, I was wearing some shirts that normally would fit, and I couldn't put them on because my arms were so swollen it didn't fit in the arms. And I am not in any way, shape, or form a hypochondriac. In fact, I'm the exact opposite. I'm basically like, cut off a limb and then I'll go to the doctor, because it's just like, I'm fine. You know, I came from that old school upbringing.
Yes.
You know, you're going to make it. Everything's going to be fine. So I had gone to breakfast with a friend of mine. And at that time, I'd literally been walking around like this for 2 weeks, having no idea what was going on the inside of me. And this particular morning, my hands, the fluid wasn't going down, and my hands had swollen up so much from my knuckles that it was starting to go into my fingers. And I was like, I don't think this is normal, because I couldn't recognize my own hands anymore. Mm. And my friend said, you know, you probably need to go to the emergency room. And I was like, and still I was not convinced. And so I called the emergency room at one of the major hospitals. Again, I live in Atlanta, so I called one of the major hospitals there. They can't give you a lot of advice over the phone, but luckily I had someone that answered the phone that said, well, if I had that kind of swelling in my arms, the first thing that I would do is go to the emergency room, because I'd be afraid of a blood clot. And I said, I'll see you in 20 minutes. So I go down there, and I'm in the emergency room. I felt fine. I was starting to feel a little bit disoriented, though. My thoughts weren't really coming together. Things were kind of a little bit woozy in my head, and I noticed that the swelling had started in my back, and it started actually in my chest area and around my collarbone.
Wow.
And it wasn't going away. And my arms had literally gotten so large, and they were so painful. I couldn't straighten out my arms. I couldn't do my hair. I couldn't brush my hair. It just took everything out of me.
Wow.
So as I'm sitting there in the emergency room, I was just like, okay, let's get this over with. Just stick some needles in me, drain me out. Again, having no idea that the condition called rhabdomyolysis actually existed, and told them what was going on. Of course, I let them know that I was doing CrossFit, and, you know, I had been traveling, and I just didn't understand what was going on. So they took me back into the emergency room, ran the blood work, and I sat there for probably 3 hours, and I was trying to figure out what was taking so long. And I was actually hungry, and I was getting ready to order Domino's to come into the emergency room. Thank God I did not. Because shortly thereafter, all of a sudden, my doctor came in, and a team of nurses came in. They ripped the curtain back, and they were very, very urgent. And they said, we were trying to figure out why this particular test, when we ran your blood work, wasn't coming back on your CPK levels, because our machine only registers to 50,000. And for the past 3 hours, your level has been so far above that, it doesn't even give us a read on what your CPK levels are. And I really didn't even understand what all of that meant until they ended up explaining it. And they said, basically what's happening is you're going into renal failure. You have rhabdomyolysis that you've gotten from working out and exercise-induced rhabdomyolysis. And because of that, you're going to be here for a little while. I had never been in the hospital before. I had never stayed one night outside of my own home. I've never broken a bone outside of a rib and a toe from martial arts and all that kind of stuff. But again, you just, it's fine. Right. You know, it'll heal. Nothing, you know, there was never any kind of hospital stay. And I had a nice little vacation in the hospital for about 5 days. They would not release me from there because they were so concerned about permanent damage. When you start hearing words like dialysis and yes, potentially being on a transplant list, something changes in you that when you realize, especially again going back to my occupation being self-employed, you realize that this is a lot scarier because it can change the complete quality of your life. And they basically said that my CPK levels in my kidneys were well over 50,000. They couldn't tell me exactly what they were, but they had been elevated like that for a long time. So they were very concerned that I had permanent damage in my kidneys. So they were talking to me about dialysis options and transplant options and kind of what the possibilities would be. And seeing someone who has never been in the hospital before and hearing all of that, it was a very scary experience.
Yes.
Especially being there by myself. And then of the very small percentage of people at the time that it was reported that actually do get rhabdomyolysis, I think at the time it was 0.96% of the population worldwide actually got rhabdomyolysis. And of that 0.96%, one in four gets it to where it attacks the liver. So my emergency room doctor comes in on a side note, and he's talking to me. He was like, "Are you an alcoholic?" And I said, "No, sir, I promise you I'm not. I'm a Christian. I work in ministry," which means nothing normally.
Right.
But for me, that's a way of life that's not something that I include. And I said, "I promise you I'm not." And he thought I was lying, which I can understand that because a lot of alcoholics, you know, they don't necessarily think that's what they are. And I said, "Sir, I promise you that's not the case here." And he said, "Well, your liver enzymes are so far off the chart."
Wow.
I think the typical is supposed to be around 45 or so, and mine were over 600.
Is that the Billy? Is that your bilirubin count?
It was something in my liver enzyme.
Yeah, that's.
So they had taken that number, and it was so far gone. They were afraid that I had permanent liver damage, and I am smart enough to understand that when someone says there's problems with the liver, that's a very serious condition. When I was sitting there in the room, and of course they popped the IV into me because they were going to rush a very aggressive amount of fluid inside me, I still really didn't understand. And I had to say to the nurse, I said, "What is rhabdomyolysis?" And she said, "Basically, you've gotten it because you've literally burst muscle tissue in your body, and it's producing a toxic protein that's going into your blood system called myoglobin. And when that myoglobin hits your kidneys, and apparently it's hitting your liver, it's trying to kill both of your vital organs. So we're concerned that you're going to go into renal failure, and we don't know what's next." In that major hospital in a major city, I was only the second person that had ever been in there with that particular condition. The other person that had been in there before was also an extreme exercise person. He did marathons. Mm-hmm. So I think CrossFit, I think, has gotten kind of a bad rap for all of that because it's been more aware.
Yes.
And I think it's kind of come to light because people have experienced that kind of condition based on CrossFit. But I love what you're doing, and I think it's so important to also notate this is for anybody that it can be for weightlifters, for extreme weightlifters, it's for marathon runners, it's for people who do this on a continuous basis. That if there's one thing that I learned through all of this, is listen to your body. I, because of the martial arts background, I was very much, you don't give up. Right. You can push through, mind over matter. And I learned that my mind is much stronger than my physical body. So I guess that was a plus. I just hated the setback because it's taken some time to get myself back to a place where I can do some physical exercise and not get it again. So after my nice little stay in the hospital for 5 days, they really didn't tell me anything else. I was not able to be released until my CPK levels were under 3,000. They wanted them to be at 1,500, and I think when I was released, they were still at 1,700, but they had come down so much with the aggressive amounts of fluid that had come in.
Right.
And because my you know, bodily functions were happening normally and things were starting to look up, I was very grateful. But it was a very scary thing because when they're talking to you about, you know, if you die, you know, and I had never been in the hospital before, and then all of a sudden they're asking you all these really, really important questions, and they want to know, and they've got nurses coming in every 2 hours checking on you because they're not really sure what's going to happen to you either. You get things in order very quickly. Yeah. And I just kind of sat in my hospital room by myself, and I just prayed to God, and I said, "If you're done with me, I've lived a really, really full life, and I am good to go." If you're not, let me walk out of here, and I would prefer that my organs are healthy and whole and young again.
Wow.
But if I have to be on dialysis, God, I trust you. You've been part of my life forever. So that means that you've got someone for me to talk there. And if I have to be on a transplant list, that means along the journey, I'm going to have to, I will be a hope and an inspiration to somebody else. I was willing to do either, but I really wanted to walk out of that hospital room 100% healthy and whole. So thankfully, 5 days later, they did another ultrasound on all of my organs, and there was no permanent damage. I didn't have to do any dialysis. My liver enzymes had come down so much they didn't see any damage to my liver from a permanent side, so I'm very, very grateful for that. But
go ahead, what are you going to say? I'll let you finish.
One of the things that they didn't put me on any kind of restrictive diet when I was in the hospital, but if there's something that I know is if you eat too much protein or if you have too much salt, it's going to combat what your body is trying to fight. So even though the hospital didn't put me on any kind of restrictive diet, I put myself on one.
Right.
Because I was like, if my kidneys are fighting to stay alive, I'm going to be nice to them. And I'm going to make sure that I'm not putting anything in my system that's going to overtax them, because I want to be able to do my part in making sure that I walk out of here 100% healthy and whole. So there comes a place where I think that we have to make some of those decisions for ourselves also. We can't just take it. You know, while I was in the hospital, I looked up the hashtag rhabdomyolysis on Instagram and found other people that had been suffering from it, because I had no clue what to expect. I didn't know. I've never known anybody with it. None of my friends had ever heard about it. Nothing. I didn't see the article circulating out on Facebook that was all about that. Apparently other people did. I did not. So having that kind of, and, you know, hashtag out there connected me with other people that had been through it, that were going through it, and I have gained so many friends and started so many conversations with people and been able to share my experience with them to give them the hope that says, look, you're going to make it, you're going to be okay. It's not necessarily the easiest road on the way back out, because the doctors don't tell you anything. Once your levels are down,
that's it.
They just kind of send you on your way, and you're good. I was so concerned about the swelling, because I was like, I felt like I looked like Shrek.
Do you know if you have any inherited genes? Like,
I don't know, but I was listening to your segment actually just before me on sickle cell, and I will probably be going back to the doctor and asking, because I've actually gotten rhabdo again.
What?
After that, I've actually gotten it two more times since then, which, based on some of the conversations I've seen online and really the community of people that have experienced rhabdomyolysis, has really what's helped me so much in the education of it, because the doctors I have found really didn't know. When I left the hospital and my levels were okay, they were like, all right, you're fine, go on your merry way. What they didn't then explain was how exhausted I was going to be for a couple of months afterwards. How I was one of the ones that suffered from short-term memory loss for about the first 6 months. And going through and listening to other people's stories, I realized that other people suffered from the same thing. It wasn't just me getting old and getting in my 40s. Thank God.
No, don't say that. Don't say that.
I know, right? And so I learned about CoQ10. Because I wasn't going to put anything in my system that was going to be anything that would be taxing to my liver or my kidneys. And in fact, 2 years later, I still won't.
Yes.
I read the labels. I won't do Tylenol. I won't do certain, you know, kinds of, you know, pain relievers, because some of those things actually can cause that damage. And I want to be on the side and air caution that, you know, they did me well once and they survived something that was very traumatic, and I'm going to be good to them.
And they really, again, did they really give you something that says this is what triggered it?
They really did not. They pretty much blamed it on the exercise, the overdoing it from the CrossFit side of things. And in my research online, what I saw was precipitators of rhabdo can be jet lag. It's exhaustion. It's dehydration.
Right.
I didn't realize I was dehydrated, and I don't know that I actually was. I don't know that there was anything any different. But But I was really exhausted, and I had very short trips back and forth from east to west coast, right. Kind of all in that same time frame.
Okay.
And again, it's just one of those things that, you know, I love. I am not a CrossFit basher. I love it. It's a discipline that I really enjoyed. I wish I could do it again, but I just can't because every time I go back, I get rhabdo again.
And that's what I want to, you know, again, is for people to understand that even for the, I mean, everything is fitness now. Everybody wants to be fit and in shape, and, you know, I'm going to 24-hour fit and doing these CrossFits, but you got to be able to go to the doctor and make sure your body is even ready for that kind of exercise. I don't think people really think about the preventive aspect of let me go get a physical, and are my organs functioning properly? Because when I had the holistic doctor on, he mentioned, you know, some people trigger rhabdomyolysis from the statin drugs, like people cholesterol medication.
One
of those. And he mentioned something that was he really couldn't get involved with, but he mentioned mercury. On how mercury can also trigger rhabdomyolysis because it sits in the muscles, dormant.
Right.
And then that perfect day could trigger that mercury, which could cause the proteins in the muscle breakdown. And when he said that to me, again, I play it back to when I got deployed in 2004 in the military, you get shots. And he says, well, you know that most of the medications are preserved in mercury. So he's like, I can't say it, but mercury is also a trigger in that. So I'm like, okay, well, I did get a shot, and so it just all kind of made sense. And then what's the thing is, a couple years, 2 years ago, I met a guy who was in the Air Force, who joined the in the Navy, 5 months. He remember, and his story was, he remembered getting the shot. And then they went off and did the battalion run, and they all, you know, they ran that 5 miles, however far they ran. And then when he got done with that run, he had the rhabdomyolysis episode, and his levels were so high that he had to learn how to walk again. He had so much muscle damage, right?
Right. Yeah. Absolutely. And what was interesting about mine is what happened. What I believe happened. I think that I had. Rhabdomyolysis, I believe, started when I did that first workout, when I had gone with those GHD sit-ups, because I never recovered from that. That swelling never went down, and I didn't realize that was abnormal swelling.
Yeah.
Something that's so much, that's not normal. And I didn't know better because I, again, come from the mentality of, oh, don't be weak. Just get in there. That came well before CrossFit, but it sure helped when I got to CrossFit to keep pushing through with that kind of mentality. And so while I was still swollen, I was going in there. So I think everything else, I think it just was an overload. When the muscle tissue was breaking down, then I kept doing other things that I didn't understand were precipitators of what all this was. It was the perfect storm for disaster in my body.
Well, the swelling is one of the, when they talk about rhabdo, the abdomen swelling is one of the areas that it's either in the abdomen or in your extremities, like your arm or elbow and things like that. So those are the two places that it shows up initially.
And what I learned is a lot of it is because your lymphatic system is overloaded and it cannot rid itself fast enough.
Right.
And then when you get that myoglobin, which is that toxic protein that's in your blood system, it's literally trying to kill your kidneys.
Right.
And your body is trying to save your life as it's processing it through. But you've got to pay attention to those signs. Like, those things are not normal.
Right.
And I love the fact of what you're doing, bringing this advocacy to people and just an understanding and a platform for even somebody like me to be able to share my story, is because I don't ever want someone to go through what I went through.
Yes.
The setbacks that I have experienced even since being in the hospital, it's not fun because I'm not excited about where I'm at as far as my physical fitness right now. Again, everything is baby steps. I literally had to start back. When I went back to CrossFit 10 months later to try to start it again, all of this happened for me in December of 2013, and I just was like, okay, it's time. And my mind was like, okay, it's time. You're fine. You're going to be okay. I went back to CrossFit. I dropped all of my weight to the lowest possible weight. Was so super cautious with everything. Took it really, really easy. And did it for about 2 weeks, and at the end of the 2 weeks, I got it again.
Wow.
And my arm started swelling up. But this time, I was smart enough to understand and see the signs, and I... Trust me, I was looking at my arms after every workout. I was making sure that I could straighten my arms after every workout because some of those pains, I still get some of those pains even if I don't work out. It's like almost like a tremor in my arms. And when I realized what was happening, thankfully I didn't have to go to the hospital this time because I recognized the signs. I put myself on bed rest. I changed my diet to make sure that I wasn't doing lots of sodium, no extra amounts of protein to kind of be anything that would be hard for my kidneys to process. And I would wake myself up in the middle of the night every 2 hours to make sure that I had 2 liters of water, to make sure that in a 24-hour period of time I had 6 liters of water.
Wow.
And it took me 4 days to recuperate from that one. And I took the measurements on my arm, and in 4 days I lost almost 3 inches of water off my elbow.
Wow.
Right at the elbow and where the bicep.
Nikki, I gotta have you come back again because I gotta go. I want to thank you for coming on and sharing your story with me. It's very important.
Absolutely, yeah. Thank you so much for the platform, and thank you so much for what you're doing.
No, thank you. I really appreciate your time, and I will definitely contact you again on social media.
All right, sounds great. Have a great day. Thanks
so
much.
Nikki, yes, thank you so much.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, bye-bye. All right, fellas, I want to thank you too also for coming on the show. I appreciate you guys.
Thank you for having us, man.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. I look forward to doing some work with you on the sickle cell awareness part of it, and with your Scholarly Me for, you know, helping out wherever I can.
We look forward to having you, my man.
All right, thank you, Doctor.
Yeah.
Man, I can't even speak. Thank you love to see you again. Thank you, man.
I'm glad we talked about me being on here for a while. So it's been a nice combination. So thank you so much for having me.
All right, thank you.
Yep.
All right, this is WDC Radio. I'm your host. I'm WDC. Again, thanks for tuning in. I'll be back next week for some more sickle cell trait awareness. So stay tuned for that. WDC Radio, LA Talk Live, and more than just talk. Sickle cell trait awareness, WDCONSCT.org. I got some information for you right there. Twitter, Instagram, at IMWDC. Thanks a lot.
Welcome to a special edition of the Breaking Chains segment here on LA Talk Live with me, Minister Joyce Dozier McNichols, along with my son, Farron Dozier, also known as WDC. This is a segment about real talk, about truth and transparency. We will be discussing the subject of the power of healing and how God will transform relationships by using traditional as well as non-traditional methods. In this case, my relationship with my son and his relationship with me. You don't want to miss this.
Son, are you ready?
Yes, Mom.
Stay tuned.